Hey friends, welcome. Today we are going to discuss theories of unimolecular gas reactions, and basically there are several theories proposed to understand unimolecular reactions, and we'll be discussing one by one all these theories. And today we are going to discuss Lindemann's theory of unimolecular reaction. Now basically, when we are discussing unimolecular reactions, what are unimolecular reactions? So reactions wherein only single molecules they react. One of the best example of unimolecular reactions are the radioactive decay reactions, wherein the radioactive decay of higher molecular weight nuclei takes place, and as a result they disintegrate into smaller daughter nuclei. So this is one of the best example of unimolecular reaction. Similarly, if we consider an example, that is N2O4 decomposition of N2O4 so into 2NO2, so this is also one of the example of a unimolecular reaction. Similarly, thermal decomposition reactions, racemization reactions, cis trans isomerization reactions, so these are some of the examples of unimolecular reaction wherein only single molecule takes place, or the reaction of only single molecule takes place. And this theory was proposed by Lindemann in around say 1922 to give the answer of the behavior of unimolecular reactions. And this theory is also explained on the basis of the bimolecular collisions. So bimolecular collision theories as well as activated complex theories you might have studied. So on the basis of the collision theory, this theory was proposed, and Lindemann, he postulated that there exists a time lag between the activation and the reaction, during which the activated molecule may either react or deactivate into ordinary molecules. So suppose, in order to understand the Lindemann theory, suppose we consider the following reaction is taking place, that is the first step of the reaction, that is two molecules of A, they are reacting to give A star plus A. So this is the first reaction, where suppose we consider that K1 is the rate constant for conversion of our starting material into the activated complex and our molecule, and K2 is again the rate constant for our activated or our decomposition of our activated molecule into again reactant. Okay, and the second reaction will be our activated complex or our activated molecule, we can write K3, where K3 is also the velocity constant or the rate constant, and it decomposes into our desired product. So this is the reactions, or these are the steps involved. Now over here, the first step is the collision between the molecule, okay, and as a result there is a formation of an activated molecule, which is represented by A star. So A star is our activated molecule, and K1 is the velocity constant. After this collision, or after the formation of the activated complex, according to Lindemann, there is a time lag that is taking place, and during this time lag the activated molecule will either decompose back, or it will lose its energy and it will be converted into the original molecule or the starting product itself with the velocity constant K2, or the activated molecule will decompose into product or will be converted into the product with the velocity constant K3. So this is the basic of the Lindemann theory. And now suppose if you want to find out the rate of all these the steps, or the rate of all the steps involved, then the first step is the rate, we can write it as rate of activation. So the rate of activation I can write, so activation energy, so K1 I can write it as into concentration of the starting material. Then the second I can write it as the rate of deactivation, that is the activated molecule is coming back to our starting material. So we can write K2 into A star into A. So this will be our rate of the deactivation. And the next is I can write rate of decomposition, or rate of formation of product. So I can write K3 into A star. So these are the three rates. And according to the steady state approximation, our activated molecule which is formed is very short lived. According to the steady state approximation, or it is generally written as SSA. So according to steady state approximation, whenever a short lived species is generated in the reaction, then at that time the rate of formation is always equal to the rate of decomposition. Okay, so over here also our short-lived species is formed, and according to the steady state approximation, rate of activation or the rate of formation of the complex or the rate of formation will be equal to the rate of decomposition, and hence according to steady state approximation I can write k1 into a, I can write a square is equal to k2 into a star into a plus k3 into a star. Okay, so this is how what I can write according to steady state approximation, as the rate of formation will be equal to the rate of decomposition, and I can take a star common and then the remaining terms will go in the denominator, and hence I will have the concentration of the activated complex will be equal to k1 into a square divided by k2 into a plus k3. So this will be the concentration of the activated complex, and now the rate of reaction is directly proportional to the concentration of the activated molecule. That is, when we, if you want to write the rate of reaction or the amount of reaction that is taking place will be directly proportional to this concentration, because only those molecules will react that are in the activated state. Okay, and hence the rate is directly proportional, or the rate will be proportional to the number of molecules which are forming or which are undergoing the activated or which are undergoing the activation, and hence we can write that the rate of reaction, rate of reaction, that is I can write it as minus dA upon dt, and this rate of reaction will be proportional to the concentration of the active complex, and hence I can write it as, in order to remove this proportionality sign, I can write it as k3 into a star. Okay, so the rate of reaction, that is minus dA upon dt, as we are writing minus because our reactant is being consumed, so minus dA upon dt will be equal to k3 into a star, and hence this value, the value of concentration of our activated complex, I can substitute it over here, and hence the rate of reaction, that is dA upon dt, will be equal to k1 k3 into a square upon k2 into a plus k3. So this representation, it gives the rate law for a unimolecular reaction, but the problem with this representation is that we cannot define the order of the reaction, or we cannot definitely say or predict the order of the reaction from this particular representation, and hence in order to find the order of the reaction we will be considering two limiting cases. Generally the cases are considered, or as we are considering the gaseous molecules, the two limiting cases that would be considered will be at very high pressure and at very low pressure. So these are the two limiting cases considered in order to simplify or in order to get the rate of the reaction using this particular representation. And suppose the first case, if we are considering that we are having very high pressure, then under sufficiently high pressure the term, that is k2a, is very very greater than k3, and as k2a is very very greater than k3, the value of k3 will be negligible or very very small as compared to this particular term. Like we have a very huge amount, and in that very huge amount we are adding very small amount, so if we are adding very small amount, then the change will be very negligible, and that negligible change can be omitted, and hence from this particular representation we can remove k3 when we are considering that our system has very high pressure, and as a result we will have minus dA upon dt is equal to, so this denominator will be removed and we will be having k1 k3 into a square upon k2 a, and a and this a will be cancelled out, and we will be having k1 into k3 upon k2 into a, and as we know that all these terms are constants, the rate, or this I can write it as k dash into a, and hence this is nothing but rate is proportional to the concentration, and it is nothing but it is the first order reaction. So thus, if the concentration of the molecule, or if the concentration of the gas is very very high, then the reaction, or then the unimolecular reaction, is always a first order reaction. So whenever, similarly the second case is that when we are considering very low pressure, and when we are considering very low pressure, then at that time the value of k3 is very very high as compared to k2a, because at very low pressure the concentration of A is very, very less, say in order of 10 raised to minus 5 or 10 raised to minus 10. So at that particular very low value, this value or 10 raised to minus 5 into K2 will always obviously be a smaller value as compared to K3, and again value of K3 is very high. So when we add both this, there will be a very negligible change or very small change, and as a result the value of K2 into concentration of A can be neglected from the denominator when we are considering that our system is at low pressure. And when we neglect this, we will have minus dA upon dt is equal to K1 K3 into A square upon K3. So this K3 K3 will be cancelled out, and we will be having only K1 into concentration of A square. So thus, whenever we are considering that a system is at lower pressure, then the rate of the reaction is second order with respect to the concentration of the molecules that we have taken or the concentration of gas we have taken. So for a unimolecular reaction, whenever a system is at high pressure, then it is first order with respect to the concentration, and when our system is at low pressure, then at that time it is second order with respect to the concentration of the reactant that we have taken, that has to be taken care of. Or this type of questions are many times asked in CSIR NET exam also. So according to this theory, the change from first order to second order kinetics as the pressure is lower. Over here, according to Lenzmann theory, when the pressure is decreased, then the order is changed from first order to second order, and this has been proved experimentally also. So there is an experimental evidence in several cases where we reduce the pressure, then at that time the order of the reaction changes from first to second. But this goes against when we are considering the radiation theory. Radiation theory, basically when we are studying the radioactive element or radioactive decay, it is a bit difficult to apply Lindemann theory. But for any other reactions or other types of reactions, this theory holds very good, and it also gives a satisfactory qualitative interpretation of unimolecular reactions, but it fails to give the quantitative aspects satisfactorily. So this was all about Lindemann theory. One more thing I want to discuss is one of the limitations of Lindemann theory. When we are discussing the limitations of Lindemann theory, in order to discuss the limitations, suppose if we consider that the reaction is a first order reaction, and suppose if we are considering that K is the rate constant, then the rate of the reaction, that is dA by dt, will be equal to K into A. Now this value I can substitute in this particular representation, that is minus dA upon dt is equal to this, and this will be equal to, I can write it as K into concentration of A. So over here I can write K into concentration of A will be equal to K1 into K3 into A square upon K2 into A plus K3. Okay, now if I rearrange this representation, that is 1 upon K into A, ultimately I am going to arrange in the form of Y is equal to MX plus C. So just C, that is 1 upon K into A into this will be numerator will be denominator, and denominator will be numerator. So we'll be having K2 into A plus K3 divided by K1 K3 into A square, and again this A I can take it into the numerator. So 1 upon K is equal to K2 into A square plus K3 into A, and I can separate out the denominator, that is K1 K3 into A square upon K1 K3 into A square. So I'm separating out the denominator, and over here A square will be cancelled out, and also this A will be cancelled out. So we are left with K2 upon K1 K3 plus also K3 K3 will be cancelled out. So we are left with 1 upon K1 into A. So 1 upon K is equal to K2 upon K1 K3 plus 1 upon K1 A. Now this is constant, so this is in the form of Y is equal to C plus MX. So over here this terms is constant, so over here we have Y is equal to C plus MX. So when we plot a graph of 1 upon K versus 1 upon concentration of A, then from this particular representation we may get a straight line from this, because Y is equal to MX plus C, we know it always gives a straight line, and the slope will be equal to 1 upon K1. So this is our predicted line, but experimentally it is observed that the line is not straight but deviates from the linearity. So this is our experimental, this is our experimental observation. So this is one of the limitations came from the representation. It should be a straight line, but from experimental result we get a curved line, or the line does not show linearity, and this deviation was removed, or this deviation was explained by Kessel, Rice and Rampensker theory, that is it is also known as KRR theory and Slater theory. So KRR theory we will be discussing in next lecture. So this limitation was removed in KRR theory. So hope the derivation and explanation of Lindemann theory is clear. So just you have to remember that whenever in case of unimolecular reaction, whenever we are having high pressure, then the reaction is, or the unimolecular reaction is of first order, and whenever the pressure is low, then the unimolecular reaction is a second order reaction. Hope the derivation and explanation was clear. Thank you very much.